بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Dear colleagues, brothers and sisters, it is a pleasure and honor for me to meet you in this eighth endoscopic ultrasound course, which will start today, Friday, and will continue over the following 4 weeks, every Friday, and the fourth one will be on Saturday. This course of endoscopic ultrasound is a basic and advanced course, and today it will be a very important day because it will include basic endoscopic ultrasound, which is very important for all of us. It will include fundamentals of endoscopic ultrasound and practical EOS examination of the pancreatic and biliary system, mediastinum, liver, and the rectum. First of all, I'd like to thank Utopia Pharmaceutical Company, who did a lot of effort to organize this course, which will be certified by the Endoscopic Ultrasound Group of the Egyptian Society of Internal Medicine with credit hours, 9 credit hours, accreditation by 9 credit hours. Thanks again for Utopia Pharmaceutical Company, and I'd like to welcome my dear colleagues in today, Professor Ahmed Murad, Cairo University, Dr. Ahmed Zamzami, and Dr. Amr Abul Magd, Military Forces Academy. And let us start our first lecture by my dear colleague, Dr. Ahmed Murad, please.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. It's a great pleasure and honor to me to be with you today in the 8th EOS course supported by Egyptian Society of Internal Medicine with the Egyptian Group of Endoscopic Ultrasound, which is a great part in Egyptian Society of Internal Medicine. And we'll start today by EOS roadmap with you, Ahmed Murad, Professor of Gastroenterology, Internal Medicine, Cairo University. We know that the hardest part of any journey is taking the first step, but don't worry, we will take it together today, inshallah. The first step will be in endoscopic ultrasound. All of us know that endoscopic ultrasound occurred or start to be evolved in 80s with a great change all over the world in all activity, political and pharmaceutical and economic. With that, endoscopic ultrasound emerged in 80s, and since then it continue to grow up all and interact the activities of upper and lower gastrointestinal tract. The main problem with EOS training is transformation from vision to imagine. All of us in childhood used to draw or imagine that the heart like that, and sometimes like that. After grown up in secondary school, we imagine that the liver like that. After we enter, we change our imagination after Faculty of Medicine. We used to imagine that the heart like that in anatomy and in pathology. And after that in surgery, and we re-change our mind to see the heart like that in echocardiography. So we always change our mind. And today we re-change our mind EUS to evaluate the abdomen and the esophagus and the mediastinum with us today. Please mute the mic. The equipment, Dr. Hussein. Mute the mic, please, Dr. Hussein. Equipment, we have a radial and longitudinal scanning. Radial scanning, it gives a cross-sectional image like of the picture of CT. And in linear, we saw a sector in front or side of the scope give ability to see the guide fine needle which path in the spectrum of the endoscopic ultrasound. So if we, for example, if we look to the aorta in the mediastinum, it look as a circle. If we look it in a transverse or with radial scope, but with longitudinal scope, it appear as a tube, which is change the appearance by change the type of endoscope. Most of our lectures all over this course will focus on the linear scope rather than the radial scope, because in Egypt, and I think in many areas, we use only the linear scope, the radial scope, the linear scope now for intervention and fine needle aspiration. The technique of EUS in a preparation as normal upper endoscopy, fasting for 7-8 hours, sedation as usual with the midazolam or propofol, usage of antibiotic prophylaxis according to American Society of Gastroenterology. They recommend only prophylactic antibiotic only in pancreatic cystic lesion FNA. If you puncture the cyst by a fine needle, you must use a prophylactic antibiotic. If you take fine needle aspiration from a solid lesion, no need for prophylactic antibiotic. In non-pancreatic cyst also, if you take a sample or you puncture a cyst, you must take a prophylactic antibiotic. So prophylactic antibiotic only in cyst puncture. If you puncture a cyst, you must give a prophylactic antibiotic. And what about anticoagulant, antiplatelet, antithrombotic drugs with EUS? American Society of Gastroenterology put the EUS, proper EUS without any fine needle aspiration is low risk for bleeding, while both patient EUS with fine needle aspiration as a high risk procedure. So fine needle aspiration is a high risk procedure. Proper EUS without fine needle is a low risk. And as regards thromboembolism risk, it categorizes the patient into high risk and low risk according to the cause of taking antithrombotic. If a patient has atrial fibrillation with valve disease, mechanical valve, the patient here is high risk for thromboembolic complication. So he has a high risk, so must take antithrombotic. In the other hand, low risk with deep venous thrombosis, he has a low risk for thrombosis. So after that, they put a patient category of high risk or low risk according to thromboembolism against the procedure risk. We know that in our lecture today, only the high risk is if you pass a needle. If you pass a needle, there is a higher risk of bleeding. If the high risk of bleeding meet the high risk of thromboembolism, for high risk FNA, you must stop the warfarin 3 to 5 days before the procedure. And for high risk of thromboembolism, you must replace it by heparin, either conventional heparin or low molecular weight heparin, and stop it just before the procedure while INR below therapeutic range. You must continue with low molecular weight heparin or heparin, conventional heparin. If there is a low risk for thromboembolism, if a patient has a DVT, you can stop warfarin safely 3 to 4 days before the procedure and reintroduce the warfarin after the procedure, and no need to take heparin or low molecular weight heparin here. In a patient on low molecular weight heparin, just omit one dose before the procedure. So you need only 8 to 12 hours of heparin before the FNA even. What about aspirin? Aspirin, which is widely used, fortunately is safe. You can continue the aspirin and do the procedure as usual, even with FNA. If a patient taking non-aspirin antiplatelet like clopidogrel or teclobidine, you must stop it from 7 to 10 days before the procedure. If you have a high risk of bleeding, means that if you take do FNA procedure. What about oral direct anticoagulant? If a patient has a low risk, means that the patient will do endoscopic ultrasound without FNA in a diagnostic procedure only. You can omit the direct anticoagulant just on the morning of the procedure. If the patient has a high risk procedure, means that the patient EOS with FNA, you must stop it at least 2 days before the procedure. If the patient has a good renal function, if the patient has bad renal function or glomerular filtration rate impairment, you must stop it 3-4 days before the procedure. Some debatable condition, what should be known before the EOS. Some doctors need nothing prior to EOS. On the other hand, they need to do all evaluation of the patient as a clinician to see all the investigation, all the previous investigation, and in Cairo University, we prefer to do that, to evaluate the patient as a clinician, not just to do EOS. On the other hand, some want to know all the imaging result before EOS, even doing transcutaneous ultrasound by the operator who will do EOS, to do it by himself, to give to take an idea about the structure of the liver, the gallbladder, before doing EOS. And some prefer to also use to do upper endoscopy before EOS to see the tract, the GI tract, if there is a diverticulum, if there is a structure, and evaluate the passage of the upper GI tract. And I think it gives also a very good idea about the tract which you pass through during a large caliber or a thick EOS. About the consent as upper endoscopy, and we with higher risk rather than upper endoscopy, because the caliber of the EOS endoscope is greater, is in diameter rather than conventional upper endoscopy. As regards coagulation test, it's better to do all before all EOS and intervention, platelet and INR, to know the coagulation profile of the patient. The position of the patient in Egypt and in Cairo University, we refer to lateral position, left lateral position. Some prefer prone, some prefer supine, but it's better for us to do a left lateral position. What about air insufflation? You know, the enemy of the endoscopic ultrasound is the air. So we just use air to pass to the antrum. Just we reach the antrum, it is better to suck the air and to proceed without air or minimal air, just to pass to the bulb and pass to the duodenum, and then suck all the air and take off or remove the endoscope without any air surrounding. You can contact the wall of the GI tract by opposing the knobs, which you, as usual we do that, or inflating a balloon. Balloon is not mandatory for imaging. I think all of us not use a balloon now. Putting air. Putting air is optional, but it is not. It's not preferred, as the air in the stomach is a large volume, need a large amount of air. A patient can be aspirated, so it is not required during imaging of the stomach. And even water cannot be stay in a duodenal bulb. Only in papilla, we may use some amount of air to see the papilla without touching it, to about from 50 milliliter water to see the papilla probably. As we said before, a water-filled balloon, it's not usually used now. The risk and the complication, first the complication and dangerous complication is perforation. Fortunately, it's not usual. It always occur in area of angulation like oropharynx and the apex of the duodenum. So we must do that in that area under vision. You must pass the endoscope under vision, not push. Just slide the scope in this area. Stenosis, especially if there is a stenosis like esophageal cancer or blind lumen, like pharyngeal or esophageal diverticulum, all this carries the risk of perforation. So some prefer to do upper endoscopy before EOS. The other risk is bleeding. It's also, thanks to God, is also rare and occur mostly in a patient in a pancreatic cyst like this, jet of blood occur, and usually it stops spontaneously after a while, meaning no need for anything, maybe some compression, it will help a lot. And usually it's spontaneous stop after a while. Infection also occur in pancreatic cyst puncture by FNA. Pancreatitis usually occur if you pass through a normal pancreatic tissue. So we try to pass the needle, if you pass a needle to take a biopsy or take FNA from a pancreatic mass, it's better to pass directly to the tumor, not passing it through a normal pancreatic tissue, which carry a risk of pancreatitis. Also, aspiration of the cyst carry a risk of pancreatitis. Tumor seeding is rarely occur if you pass through a normal tissue, so it's better to pass, if you want to pass through a pancreatic mass, it's better to do it from the duodenum, as the duodenum will be removed during Whipple operation rather than passing from the stomach. Bile peritonitis, left adrenal gland hemorrhage, all these are risk and complication of EOS. You see that all the complication occur during FNA and mostly during FNA of assist or during intervention of assist. Common indication, the most important indication of EOS is pancreatic solid or cystic lesion. The pancreas is the main indication for EOS. A chronic abdominal pain, especially with pancreatitis, especially with idiopathic pancreatitis, searching for the cause or the hidden cause, submucosal or subepithelial lesion, esophageal cancer staging, ambulatory staging, cancer staging, cancer rectum, lung or mediastinal cancer staging, and FNA. And some intervention like celiac plexus block, transmural drainage of pancreatic cyst, pseudocyst, US guided biliary drainage, or US fine needle of anti-tumor agent, radio frequency ablation, cryo, or photodynamic therapy. Linear EOS give us a chance to do a real time visualization of the needle during its passage in a tumor in front of the probe. So we can direct the needle to pass through a tumor to take an FNA or to inject something if you want to inject. On the other hand, the linear endoscope is limiting scanning range, so you must manually rotate the scope during examination to see the circumferential view of the scan. The other modality we use by EUS is EUS elastography, which evaluates the tissue stiffness. Tissue stiffness means that if there is a hard tissue, means that it is more with malignant and soft tissue more with benign. It is a soft wear to measure the stiffness of the tissue surrounding by pressure of a vascular pulsation or respiratory movement on the lesion, you can evaluate the stiffness of the lesion. It gives us colors, different color from blue, which indicates that it's a hard tissue go with malignancy, to red and green tissue, which is go with benign lesion. It can evaluate some lesion like this. I don't know if it is a malignant or a benign lesion. After elastography, it's completely green. It go with that. It is a benign lesion, so it will evaluating after that, and it's a pancreatic teratoma. So it can evaluate before EUS, FNA, and it can guide also with FNA if there is some hardness here. It is a target for the FNA. It can be helped to some extent, not a magic, but it can be helped. Here, the blue color is diffuse, and all the lesion mostly is blue color, which go with ductal or adenocarcinoma of the pancreas. On the other side, another modality, which is contrast enhanced EUS. This lesion, we don't know what is this. Is it a cyst with necrotic tissue inside, or a mass with liquefaction, and this is a solid lesion, or a cyst with the solid nodule in a mural nodule inside? We cannot decide that. By contrast enhanced, we inject by a needle in a vein a material which like Sonoview, which is a gas field. This is a gas field micro bubble enveloped in a albumin or phospholipid shield. It go with the flow of blood and reach the small capillary microvasculature of the lesion. Here, this is our lesion. We don't know before what is this nature, what's its nature. Here, it's disappear. It means that it is not a vascular lesion. It is not, it don't have any microvasculature. So the negative for tissue, it is not a tissue, it is just a necrotic tissue, so it's just a cyst, and this is a necrotic tissue inside a cyst, and it is a pancreatic pseudocyst. The other role of EUS in subepithelial lesion, the EUS have advantage of delineating the layer of the GI tract. It differentiated generally into five layers. The first layer, which is the outer inner layer, which is the outer part of the mucosa. It gives a hyperechoic, means that it's more white. And after that, it's muscularis mucosa, which is the black. Always muscle is black, hypoechoic. And after that, the submucosa, which is hyperechoic, which means white. And after that, muscle again, which is the muscularis propria, the proper muscular layer, and always muscle is black, hypoechoic, and the outer is subserosa. If we found a lesion in a subepithelial lesion, we can know the layer of origin, and by knowing the layer of origin, we can know the type of the lesion. Here, this is the first layer, which is the mucosa, and this is the muscularis mucosa, the hypoechoic layer. And after that, the submucosa, a white layer, and the inner one of a hypoechoic is the muscularis propria. Here we found the lesion originate from the fourth layer muscularis propria. It limit the differential diagnosis of the lesion that is it's a lesion originating from a muscle layer. It limit the differential diagnosis into one or two disease. So it will help a lot. And by US also, we can take a fine needle aspiration if we need from a submucosal or subepithelial lesion. By adding microprobe, it is a higher frequency. It reach up to 20 megahertz. It's divide the layer of the GI from five layers by conventional EOS. By a probe, you can reach up to 9 layer and more than 9 layer. You can differentiate the superficial mucosa into epithelium, first and second layer epithelium, and there is lamina propria, and after that muscularis mucosa, the fourth one, and after that the outer the layer of the muscularis propria into three layer, inner circular, outer longitudinal, and in between connective tissue, and the outer adventitia or serosa. So by this maneuver, you can differentiate the layer into 9 layer rather than 5 layers. At the end, some general rules of EOS. Always try to use the endoscope like a rope, not a rod. Just minimal movement to reach the proper view of the lesion. Not use it vigorously, not use it as a rod. To move it vigorously, you will not see probably all the lesion, and you must do a micro movement. As we said, micro movement to delineate the lesion probably. A rotation, you have two rotation, either rotation to the right, which is a clockwise, and it will see the patient left, like if it's in the stomach, it will see the spleen. If you rotate to the left, you will see the right of the patient, which is probably the liver. We must delineate the lesion, and if you give a comment on the lesion, you must comment on its echogenicity. Is it isoechoic? Means that it's surrounding tissue, the same texture. Hypoechoic is more black than the tissue, darker than the tissue. Hyperechoic is white, is bright, rather than the other tissue surrounding. It go with the calcification, calculi or fat. Sometimes if you diagnose that, you can diagnose the lesion by just echogenicity. Like a liboma, it is hyperechoic. Hyperechoic lesion in a subepithelial lesion, it's always a fat, usually a fat, and it can be diagnosed by this only. Anechoic lesion, it go with the cyst, gallbladder, or vascular structure, and it will help a lot. Doppler add many advantage to evaluate the structure. If you have two tubular structure, by applying Doppler, you can delineate. This is the duct of this is the biliary duct, and this is the vessel. So you can delineate which is vessel, which is duct, and it gave you a lot of help. Also, pulse wave Doppler, you can differentiate between venous and arterial vessel. If you lost during EOS, you must re-evaluate yourself, where I am. So if you are in a confused, or you are lost your way, you will ask you three questions. Focus on three questions: where, what, and how. Where I am, anatomical, where my tip of the scope is. And then after you know where you are, you must know, what can I see here? If I am in the duodenum, what the structure, I must be evaluated in this area. If you are in the stomach, in the first part, in the antrum, in the lower esophagus, you must know the anatomical structure surrounding you in this place. At the end, how can I see this structure? So wherever you are, you must ask yourself three questions: where I am, what can I see here and how can I see it? This is a very important lecture about EUS station. It will divide the station of endoscopic ultrasound into five stations. Station one below the babilla. If you are below the babilla, you know you are where? You are in a below the babilla. And here you ask yourself, what can I see here below the babilla? I can see 1, 2, 3, 4. The last question, how can I see this structure? This lecture will be with Prof. Hussein Okasha, my dear brother and dear friend. He will give you a very important lecture about EUS station, and you will meet again next time with esophageal masses, inshallah. Thank you so much.